Right, I remember Ian Hunter saying, who wants to write about Watford? And I thought, I'd do, like that. It seemed more sense than writing about Memphis. Mm. Always seemed more sense. And to be a person, it's not to be nationalistic, it's to be characterful, to be where you come from. And, you know, a person like me is, I suppose, more of an actor than a singer, and I write my own scripts, and I couldn't write outside my experience to save my life, because it wouldn't be convincing to me, let alone to anyone else. And I'm personally bored to death with the sound of the word Memphis. I just can't stand it. Unless it's Chuck Berry.
Yeah.
I mean, I love Chuck Berry's version. Oh, all kinds of undercurrents are set up by extreme success, which, in fact, I don't think anybody needs. I don't give a damn if I never get in the charts again, quite honestly. If I'm writing songs that are going to sustain us through our concerts, Spasticus, to me, is a song that is going to live in our act for the rest of my days. And that kind of song is more important to a career than whether it was a massive, you know, commercial success or not. Commerce is a thing that I need enough of to survive, but not enough of to destroy the spirit. And being hungry and being slightly looking upwards all the time is much better than looking downwards at your expensive shoes with your chunky gold bracelet around your crocodile skin neck. Nobody in all the 10 years I've been doing rock and roll music has ever actually been nasty to me. Nobody. Nobody's ever had a go at me. Nobody's ever told me I should stop, even though I felt that I ought to myself sometimes. And nobody's ever told me that it was all a kind of a wasted exercise, you know. So that when you get a kind of a group, well, it's anti-anthropology, it's anti-history, it's anti-experience, it's anti-human nature, rock and roll. Because it's a group of people who are all, by necessity and definition, they're ego trippers, kind of sharing their egos and pooling their resources. I did three LP sleeves when I was a graphic designer. One was Frank Sinatra, one was Instruments of the Orchestra, and the other one was Vera Lynn. Do you remember good old Vera? Yeah, like £23 for each one, took me 2 weeks. I had to get all her wrinkles off. No, I'm not World Record Club, didn't pay too well, and didn't credit it either. And I had to get Vera's wrinkles off, and I'd fixed it. We'd fixed it. You know, the old pencil. They said, too many wrinkles on the phone. I was rubbing it off. It was a press photograph with a flash, you know, when it all hangs out. Gels time. Gels in the garden moored. I could hear my gels flapping up the stairs behind me, said Paul McCartney, as he got older, for some reason. People think I'm boxing clever all the time, really. A lot of people don't trust me because they think I'm brainy in it, and I ain't really brainy. I'm just, I'm a person who's had lots of different experiences just through life without ever engineering it particularly, and I can sort of call on those experiences if in a given situation. One can, for instance, I can adopt the guise of a London hard nut with a verbal, which I've learned from London hard nuts, which I'm not, but just the attitude of a London hard nut. Or another time I can pretend that if it's necessary I'm going to go back to hospital for 3 years. I'm not worried about it, you know. There's a story about, it's got nothing to do with what I'm saying, about Matisse, that he bought a Cezanne for about 20 quid. I think before Cezanne died, in like about 1905 or something, in Paris. And it was at a time when Matisse was very broke. And he had that painting, and he used to get up in the morning, come downstairs, before he went to work, have his bit of breakfast, and look at the Cezanne. It was apparently one of the mountain paintings, just a pure landscape, no figures in it. Cezanne wasn't a great figure painter, he was a great earth painter. And he looked at it for an hour, every morning. Matisse would look at his picture and get so high off it that he'd go and work for 15 hours. He was skint for another 10 years after Cezanne had died and become a hot property. And an American dealer offered him $1 million for it. And he said, leave it out, mate. I need that more than I need $1 million. And he kept it and left it to somewhere nice, some little funny little gallery in France. And hearing that story is enough to make me want to kind of know that I can turn the money away, turn the fame away, turn the even the understanding from the audience away, if necessary, in order to just follow the... It may not even be the truth. It's just what I'm... I think being selfish is not being selfish if it's not getting you anything. It's being what you've got to be. And I hate being famous sometimes. I mean, a lot of the time, I think everybody probably does. I hate being regarded as better than I think I am, because I don't really even want to feel that good. I don't want to feel superior to anybody, or inferior. It's a horrible feeling, inferior, which I think we all feel quite a lot of the time. I just want to feel equal. And making my bit of jobs, I don't really want to be no more important than like the bloke who makes the chairs or the bloke who delivers the milk, really. Just useful, and if it's useful to other people, like in the way that I think David Bowie is probably more important in my mind as a person who's probably inspired hundreds of other people to do likewise or whatever their version of likewise, rather than as a great artist or something. I just think he can tap people's, like, it can encourage people, because it's not so far removed from them that they don't identify with it fully and want to do it. And that's where really people like David Bowie are important. And perhaps I'm a bit, as a lyric writer, maybe I'm too flash, or maybe I make people think they're not very good at it, and which is not good, you know. It's like, I don't want to be Muhammad Ali, however much I like him. I want to wind other people up. I think that's probably more important. Art is really perhaps a very political thing. Any kind of art, any kind of joyful life, any kind of life that can bring your own self a pleasurable existence is the most politically important thing really that exists, because that's really, the revolution begins in the living room. It's not a written down manifesto. It's about your own individual existence. It's not about anything else. If it is, then you either think you're God or you think you're a germ, you know. There's no two ways about it. And I don't want to be that. I don't think anybody else wants to be that. Well, art is political, really, because it's going to be more important every 20 minutes for the rest of our lives and the rest of the world's life. It's going to be the thing that everyone's going to need one day for themselves. Art, being a great artist, is as unimportant as a box of matches. Being an artist is as politically important as... If the whole world was artists, there wouldn't be no shooters, and everyone would be getting off on it. Everybody can do it. We're all born equal. The only thing that's different is opportunity and experience. And art for the unemployed will be employment for the employable, and we can all do our art, man. We can all do it. Everyone can do it. Any prat can learn to draw, because I was totally, I learned by just trying quite hard, admittedly, and being motivated, luckily, which, you know, is not there for everyone. Motivation itself, the will to do it, isn't always invested in our kind of childhood. But I've been writing a song called The Brutal Hiawatha for the last 4 years, and the words are naked, swearing, blind, aggression. Learn that first when just a baby. Teach that fucking noisy baby. Hit that kid. Bash! Hit it again for good measure. Bash, bash! Like that, which is what happens, you know?